So, we will now try to establish the difference between classical and operant conditioning. Okay. Number one, you realized in the case of classical conditioning, Pavlov's dog, okay, that the dog was involuntarily, you know, behaving in a particular way. That was purely a biological reflex, and that got conditioned. No? Salivation was a biological response; it got conditioned. Whereas in the case of pigeons, the pigeon was deliberately pecking in order to receive a particular type of a response. So, in the case of Pavlov's dog, it was the biological reflex that got conditioned, whereas in the case of Skinner's pigeon, it was the choice of the pigeon to peck at a particular point in order to get food. Okay. So, operant conditioning basically engages your voluntary behavior, whereas classical conditioning, it engages your involuntary behavior, the reflexes. Two, in classical conditioning, it is a mechanistic process of formation and strengthening of the SR association, the stimulus response association. Okay. Whereas, in the case of operant conditioning, you realize that the SR association, the formation as well as the strengthening is non-mechanistic and it is basically a voluntary process. Okay. You want something to be done, you want say the aversive stimulus to be removed, or you want the reward to be given, and therefore, you give a desired type of a response. Okay. Therefore, it is voluntary, it is non-mechanistic. Third difference between classical and instrumental conditioning is that the in case of classical conditioning, the stimuli act upon the individual and then the individual responds automatically. Okay. So, there is no goal that has been set by the individual, the organism, the participant. Okay. And the participant does not give a response in order to achieve that very goal. Whereas, in the case of operant conditioning, there is a goal that you set for yourself. Okay. You receive a positive feedback, or you realize that the aversive stimulus is being removed, and therefore, the response is actually controlled by the individual, so that the goal can be attained. Okay. Say for instance, you know that if you perform well in your exam, okay, your achievement score will be appreciated by your school, and you will then receive, say for instance, President's medal or say a scholar badge. Okay. Now, receiving the medal, getting the scholar badge, this is the goal that you have set for yourself. Okay. And you know that in order to attain this very goal, you have to respond in a particular way. That means, your scholastic achievement should reach a level which would be finally fetching you this reward. So, in this case what happens? You voluntarily in a non-mechanistic way, you participate in the process, you have understood the meaning of the reward, you have understood what recognition, the reward, the prize means. Okay. You give a response which basically helps you achieve that very goal. In the case of classical conditioning, that does not happen. No? The individual works automatically, it is a biological reflex, it is a natural response. Okay, which gets somehow anchored to a particular type of a stimuli. Okay. Just think of the other example. You have seen pickles in your kitchen or on your dining table, and whenever you look at the pickle of your choice, say for example, the lemon pickles, you have watering in the mouth. But watering of mouth is the secretion of saliva in your oral cavity, but then this is a biological response. This biological response somehow got associated with the pickles which are present on your dining table. Okay. You did not set a goal for yourself, it has happened. So, the response is automatic in the case of classical conditioning, whereas in the case of operant conditioning, you set a goal and then you try to achieve it. Therefore, what happens? Classical conditioning becomes a passive process, whereas operant conditioning becomes an active process. Okay. In terms of rewards, in case of classical conditioning, the reward precedes response, okay, because of the temporary association. Okay, you remember Pavlov's dog? The food was presented and that led to salivation. Okay. Pavlov collected that saliva and then he tried to, you know, pair the tone of the bell with the presentation of the meat powder. This means the reward was given to the dog beforehand. So, in case of classical conditioning, the reward precedes the response. Okay, whereas in the case of operant conditioning, reward always follows the response. Okay, so therefore, it is contingent upon the reoccurrence of the response. Okay, so the crawling baby lifts the body, and then the elderly mole says, "Oh, great, great, great! Yes, yes, yes!" The child realizes this is a doable act. The child, human children, they fall several times when they attempt to walk. Okay, but then they do make this attempt. They actively engage in the process. Their every attempt is, you know, rewarded by the parents. The reward is contingent upon the reoccurrence of the situation. So, every time the baby tries to lift the body and stand erect and try to walk, parents appreciate. This appreciation works as a reward, and this finally makes the human baby walk. Okay. So, reward is always contingent upon the occurrence of the response. So, that is the big difference in terms of classical and operant conditioning. Now, come to the CSUCS pairing, no? The conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus. The association between the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus in the case of classical conditioning depends on contiguity of the stimulus, okay? How contiguous they are. Okay? You remember contiguity, we said that how closer the two situations are. So, if the sound of the bell and the presentation of the meat powder simultaneously, if that happens, then you consider, the respondent considers that this was basically, these two things cannot be delineated, they cannot be separated. You consider them to be one ensuring the presence of the other. In the case of human beings, the best example could be when you use words which are not to be used in a civilized society. And immediately, you know, your teacher or your parents, they punish you for that. What happens? The word that you speak and the consequence that you get. Okay. You consider that these two things are associated, and this helps you learn certain things. Okay. In the case of operant conditioning, the response reinforcing stimulus, that gets associated. And this association depends on the consequence of the response. Okay. So, whether it is contiguity or it is the consequence. Okay. So, these two things again differentiates between classical and operant conditioning. Mostly, if you look at the examples of classical conditioning, you would realize that it is animal learning where you readily find classical conditioning taking place, and mostly in the case of human beings you would realize that it is the operant conditioning that takes place. You might have seen people around you who would look at a particular bird in the sky. You have the blue color bird, okay. And there are mythological stories suggesting that this bird basically is somewhere associated with God. And you have always seen your parents, they do like this whenever they see this very bird. Now, what happens? You are neither appreciated for this behavior, you are neither given negative feedback for this very behavior. But you somehow develop affinity for that very bird, and driven by that mythological concept, you also start repeating that very behavior. But there are very few things, say watering of mouth when you look at pickles, or behavior like this, which you realize can be suitable examples in case of human beings for classical conditioning. But by and large, classical conditioning examples are very readily, easily available in the animal kingdom, whereas human beings, you will find mostly they use operant conditioning. Let us now make a comparison of our day to day experience and try to fit it with the these two theories that we have talked about. Classical and operant conditioning, both of them, they talk about certain direct experiences that we have. Both of them have an element of reinforcement or punishment. Okay. But But is it that our entire learning is dependent on direct experience? Is it that our entire learning is based on punishment and reinforcement? The answer is no. Okay. And this leads to the fact that there is a possibility of a learning where you basically watch somebody, you try to imitate him or her, and therefore you learn that very thing. Okay. So, this type of learning they are called observational learning. Now, Albert Bandura was the man who proposed the social learning theory, and the social learning theory has given utmost importance to observational learning. What does observational learning say? Observational learning basically says that you pay attention. Whom do you pay attention to? Of course, you will search for an idol for yourself, a model for yourself. So, you choose a model, something which you consider worth replicating. You adore your model, you attend to his or her behavior. Then the behavior of the model you retain with yourself, you then try to imitate it, that is the motor reproduction. Okay. So, you try to imitate that behavior, and when you imitate it, okay, the world around you appraises you. Okay. This appreciation becomes a reinforcement for you. So, observational learning, which basically helped you attain to a model, retain certain aspects of his or her behavior, reproduce it in your own behavior, and when you repeat it in your own behavior, you are being reinforced. Okay. So, this is how observational learning works. Now, our complex behavior basically are the result of exposure to competent models who display appropriate behavior basically in terms of solving problems and coping with the world. Okay. The major world leaders, you remember when we started our first lecture, okay, and I showed you certain lines and told you that can you make sense of what you see here. Okay. Although I was talking with reference to sensation and the process of assigning meaning. But we took Mahatma Gandhi as an example there. Why did we take Mahatma Gandhi as an example? Because you realize that there are certain type of scenarios in the socio-political situation in the world, which has its inbuilt problems. Somebody who shows you the path ahead, the way ahead, okay, how to resolve these very problems, how to cope with the problems that you see in your world. Okay. Those are the people who would be considered as models. But it is not, I am not suggesting that you have to have role models equivalent to the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi, to select a model. You can have models who are readily available to you. Okay. Mostly inside the house, you would realize that one of the parents, they become the model. Okay. Mostly the psychoanalytic perspective will tell you and commonsensical experience will tell you that mostly the girl child would love to imitate the mother, the boy child would like to imitate the father. Then gradually with your increase in age and experience, when you move out of the house, you have multiple individuals to choose from. Okay. You love acting, you love a particular actor or actress. Okay, you start imitating him or her. Okay. Your style of walking, the way you dress, the way you groom yourself, okay, is highly influenced by those models. So, basically what happens? You select a model, okay, and when you select a model from your contemporary environment, then you try to imitate the behavior that you adore. Okay. And this is how observational learning works. Now, the basic assumptions in social cognitive theory basically says that you choose a model and learning is basically internal in nature. Internal in nature means, unlike the two cases that we discussed, the classical and the operant conditioning, where the behavior was very glaringly visible. Okay. The pigeon would peck, okay, the dog would salivate, pickle will lead to watering in the mouth. Okay. In the case of human beings, it might not be that the behavior that you have learned will always result into a very, very glaringly visible behavior. It could be you are not able to see any result. You choose a model, you observe the model, but then learning is very, very internal in nature. Okay. And this internal nature of learning does not make others realize that this individual has already learned this very behavior. But at an appropriate time, the individual reflects that very behavior, and then you realize, oh, I did never realize that this person has learnt it, but he really did so. The third assumption in social cognitive theory is that the behavior is goal directed in nature. Okay. You have selected a model and you are trying to imitate the model because you want yourself to be like him or her. Okay. So, you have a goal at hand and your behavior is directed towards that very goal. And finally, eventually behavior becomes self-regulated. Okay. So, all you want to achieve as a human being is a self-regulatory state. Interestingly enough, Edward Tolman, he challenged the assumption of behaviorism. He explained that living beings are basically information processes, they are active information processes, and we construct cognitive map of the experience, and it is this cognitive map which guides our behavior. Okay. And Tolman's interpretation of conditioning was basically in terms of expectations. He talked about latent learning, and of course, with respect to formation of the mental map, he gave the concept of cognitive map also. Now, latent learning basically is the learning of things that are learned without being reflected in immediate behavior. Right now, with respect to assumptions, we talked about it. And Tolman's view was that cognitive maps, it facilitates latent learning. What is cognitive map? It is nothing. It is simple mental images of the spatial environment, okay, which helps us resolve the problem, the challenges that the world poses before us, the environment poses before us. Okay. Say for instance, the best example would be root memory. For example, you have your house, you have your school or college, and you know this is the route that can be taken to reach the destination. You know the alternate route also, and you know that if these two routes are blocked, then what to do? You have the cognitive map. Okay. The problem solving ability that you reflect in a given situation is dependent on your cognitive map. Okay. It is a latent learning. It is not that every day you repeat it, you are rewarded, or some punishment is given to you, or the situation is very obnoxious and it is withdrawn when you come forward with a desired behavior. Nothing of that sort happens here. Okay. So, this is the importance of cognitive learning.